Hey everyone, what's happening? This is Norm Schriever with the Who in the World podcast. Today we have episode number 30. And it's a privilege in this episode to introduce you to my friend KK. KK and I became friends when I was living in Cambodia about 10 years back. And I met this whole really interesting, crazy, dynamic group of Cambodian Americans who had been deported. They were called the Deportees, deported from the U.S. wherever they were living to Cambodia. And a lot of them had troubled pasts. They lived in poverty, in bad neighborhoods, were in gangs, were in prison, immigration jail in the U.S. And so that was the reason ostensibly they were deported. Unfortunately, the transition was really hard on a lot of these deportees, as you could imagine, and not really being able to regroup and refocus and restart their lives. So I have the utmost respect for KK because he hit the ground running in Cambodia. Soon after, KK started the early roots of what became Tiny Toons, which is still a nonprofit in existence, which helps a ton of street kids in Cambodia. I'll read off their website. Tiny Toons uses breakdancing and the culture of hip-hop to engage, inspire, and educate youth from some of Cambodia's most impoverished neighborhoods. All that's definitely true. KK just is a miracle worker with these kids, and they love him and respect him, and he brings them into the center. Early on, it was just out of his house, and there was no funding to breakdance and rap and, you know, learn about hip-hop and the culture and the togetherness and tagging and artwork. And then it really expanded and got funding. And then he, of course, him and all the other people at Tiny Toons, they teach these kids, you know, proper schooling and life skills and what they need to succeed in the business world there in Cambodia. So he's gotten, I don't even know how many, but I'm sure it's hundreds and hundreds of kids off the streets, got them a better life, a safe home, got them jobs, and just a brighter future. I have the utmost respect for anyone who dedicates their lives to helping others. And just like most people, KK isn't perfect, and he definitely has a checkered past, as you'll hear about. But I think you'll really enjoy this podcast and KK's story. This is part one of his journey. We were able to sit down face to face outside on a hot night with a couple beers in front of his house there in Phnom Penh, Cambodia, and talk about his life's journey. So it is a two-hour conversation. And so this is part one, and I'll bring you part two coming very soon. Until then, enjoy part one of this podcast with KK and Tiny Toons on the Who in the World podcast. Let's go! Step into a world where there's no one left. But the very best no MC can take. So what kind of programs, when you guys are open there, what kind of programs you got going?
So we, you know, we have rap classes, DJ classes, graffiti and arts, and breakdance.
And breakdance, yeah.
But then we lost two of our, like, teacher, our DJ equipment is all messed up.
Yeah.
It's hard to get them needles, and then... Most of our kids that learn how to DJ, now they work in clubs. They don't got time to come back and give back to the next generation.
Yeah,
so, but I understand all that.
Yeah.
They're still teenagers. They're making their money. So the only thing we have is making beats, rapping and singing.
Well, now,
and breakdancing.
You talk about a needle on a record, and like 80% of them don't even know what that is, right?
Yeah,
they're like,
so,
we're ancient, bro.
And, you know, for the needle, for the DJ equipment, it's like $40 a piece for the needles.
And those go quick.
And Cambodia don't have it.
Yeah.
We got to get it shipped here.
Yeah. With the foundation, where are you guys located?
Right now, Tiny Toons at Chibamba. We've been there about 10 years now.
So is that the same as back in the day? Yeah, when I was here, like 14 to 16, I think it was?
No, 14, yeah.
Yeah.
Chibamba.
Yeah, I came and visited you guys out there at one point, right?
Yeah.
So same building and everything?
Same building, same thing. The only thing that is the rent going up.
Yeah.
It's got going higher and higher.
Probably every year it goes up and stuff, right? Landlords.
Every 2 years.
Every 2 years.
Yeah.
But when it go up, it's like $200-$300 on us. Every.
That hurts, man, yeah. Right?
Yeah, it's kind of hard. To me, I just look at it like, damn, so we're struggling, and the U.S. is struggling, your mom sends you money, you gotta have a certain time when you get this, go pick up money and come back, pay. And like you say, the food's all skyrocket.
Man, and it's like it's like the rich get richer by like double over 2 years, the whole world over, man, you know?
Yeah, they got it.
And that's what you're saying, like rents go up, this, that, everything's harder to buy. Land prices, car prices, food, everything.
Everything, brother, everything.
Yeah, so how many kids you got in Tiny Toons now?
We still around 100 kids per day.
That's a lot.
Yeah, we still 100 per day. Like, even with COVID, every time we get a chance to open up, we try to buy rice, noodles, you know, canned foods.
Yeah.
And give them a little package every time there. But, you know, we don't have that much money, but we do the best we can.
Do the best we can,
so, why COVID was locked down for almost 2 years.
Yeah.
Every like 3 months we give a little package to all our kids.
And they take it home, and that might, I mean, what should be a couple days might be a couple weeks.
For so we try our best, and that's what we did. And I try to take care of all my staff, you know, that was working for us. I know they're 100, you know, 150 ain't gonna, 200 ain't gonna really, they got rent too.
Yeah,
so
that's
one thing I did is just, you know, tell the donors, we apologize, but I can't let my staff starve.
Because also
that.
Then, practically, once they go, they're probably never coming back because they have to go get other jobs.
Yeah,
so in the province. Or,
we
know.
Lost, like, a lot of our staff because of that. So, now some staff is complaining of, like, we're late sometime on certain things or, like, our money, they can't get a raise.
Yeah.
But, you know, Tiny Toon has been with the struggle from the get-go. Every time we do a little bit good, but it don't last long. A little bit good is not
And you know the struggle ain't going away.
Yeah, you know.
It's part of the plan.
It's part of us being part of the ghetto. And then we have like computer classes, chemistry classes, math classes, and then sometime we have our own library where kids can go read.
That's
and
awesome,
stuff.
Man.
And then we have PE too.
Yeah.
You know, because you know I look at dancing as part of PE, but we still want, you know, not all kids want dancing.
Yeah.
Or breakdancing. So we have PE where they basketball, volleyball, tennis, but we don't got no big place to play tennis and all that.
Something's better than nothing.
Yeah, so
because again, these days, kids will stay in the room all day to sit on their phone and not get out and stuff. So there's a program that I volunteered for very shortly in Medellin, Colombia, which is a great place, but grimy as hell, man. It's like some of the ghettos there, you know, the barrios, ooh, Lord. But
they actually have this program, a social program in a really bad neighborhood, and they started with just soccer, because everyone loves soccer there. And once they had the kids in for soccer, they were like, all right, but then you're going to sit with this class, and you're going to go to this program, and you're going to learn this. So same sort of thing. You give them the fun stuff that's cool, and then, by the way, you're taking a math class, so you're taking a computer class, right?
Yeah. That's what we use as our tools.
Yeah.
Fishing the kid back to school.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool, man. And what kind of donors do you have? Like a steady regulars, or is it like small, big, they come, they go?
Right now, we have zero donors. Mm. We have, for fun, little donors, I'm talking about like on the website and stuff.
Yeah.
We have little donor, but funders, we have zero right now.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
So our NGO is straight broke. We're surviving because of donations.
And yeah. Stuff like that. Yeah.
So, but hope, how long can that last? So.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we've been going through this for the last three months now, four months.
Yeah, it's tough. Well, hopefully this helps, gets the word out there. I'll put the link in, link in the description. It'll be on YouTube, all that stuff. You never know, some people might listen. You know?
Yeah, you know, and we're looking for a person that know how to write grants and find grants. And
yeah.
That's what we need right now, so.
Now, are you looking for a 50-year-old, out of shape, like rapper, breakdancer, a white dude or something? Because I could volunteer, you know, I could get in there.
Yeah, you know, you're always
you're like,
welcome,
yeah,
bro.
No,
you know?
No, but you're like, no, just write a check.
You know, like me, I can't breakdance no more. But I can still show them the way how to get to the next level.
Yeah.
You know, I can't spin on my head 100 times no more.
Yeah.
Flare or air tracks. Like
but you know the technique.
Yeah.
Right? And you know the skills.
I've been there. I know it.
Yeah, yeah.
But now, I'm out of shape. My health condition is all bad now.
Yeah. We tried doing that shit. We'll break a hip, man.
Yeah.
We're the next. Now it's not even one generation. It's two generations beneath us, man.
Yeah. So I'm still trying, you know, still fighting.
You'll get there, man. You'll get there.
Yeah.
You know, there's a greater purpose to it all. You know, it's like, shit, you got to. I'm sure you've had so many moments like that where it just all looked like it wasn't going to work and somehow it goes
forward. Yeah, Tiny Toon's always been a roller coaster for us. Mm. It's like this, you know, but this is like one of the worstest.
We
had to ask people really to donate to help us keep the door open, you know. So right now, this month, I don't even know how I'm going to pay the staff.
And how long has Tiny Toon's been around? Like, when did you found it?
2004, so we're about 18 years.
That's crazy, almost coming up on 20 years, huh?
Yeah, so I'm just saying, like, you know, but we only could claim, we could say about 15 or 14 years because of the license.
So
whenever the license get approved, that's when we could claim how long.
But in reality.
We've been before the license even existed. Yeah, yeah. We was doing real street stuff, you know, so.
Man, so take me back to that, like, was 2004, is that when you first?
Yeah, when I first arrived here, working for Gaussang, volunteering, not even working, volunteering, and running the outreach team.
Yeah.
Going around, that's how I meet all these poor kids from the projects. And then when the homie say, KK used to break dance, I'm like, man, I've been in prison like so long, break dancing. And then I wasn't feeling it at first. I was like, hell nah.
Yeah.
I'm trying to like, what you say, live life, enjoy life, and just trying not stress about my people, my son in the state.
Yeah.
But then it was these kids that kept on coming to my house. They was at my house. And finally I said, once a week.
And that's the thing, it's like, when they're saying, be a part of this organization or do this or help, it's like, but when a kid comes up to you and is interested, how can you turn that down, right?
Yeah,
that's all love, right?
You know, a bunch of kids trying to break dance with you, so to me, it touched me.
Yeah.
But I was like, damn, that's cute, man.
Plus, it's better that they're doing that. That's the whole point,
right?
It's better doing that than what else they could be getting into on the streets.
Yeah, so that's how I end up teaching once a week. But after a month later, it just got deeper and bigger.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, like 3 months later, I give them my house key where they They took over the house.
No kidding. It was right
in
your house.
Yeah, there was nothing in the house anyway, but a bed on the floor, a TV, a $50 apartment. Help yourself, man. Go ahead. You know, eat whatever you want to eat, whatever. Yeah, and then all suddenly, like 6 months down the road, or eight, close to a year, I noticed these kids is living with me. Some of them just like.
You're like, you've been here all week.
Hey, man, go on, man.
Wow.
Yeah, then I start figuring out, damn, some of y'all don't go to school. Some of y'all, that's how I really got start pushing myself more of helping these kids. That's when I went to every NGO that I was that I know and asked, like, call sign. Where I worked at, I was like, man, is there any way these kids can come to school or get free food?
Yep.
They're like, nah, they got to be drug use. I'm like, what the hell? They're poor kids. I go to WAC, the Wag Boat Girls.
Okay.
I went and asked them, and then Marianne was running. She was the founder and director, and they say they only help sex workers and stuff like that. And then I went to another NGO that was working with orphans. Now they only take orphans.
Yeah.
Like, so how about these other kids? Y'all playing politics. Y'all like gangbangers, you know?
Yeah.
To me, in my heart, everybody's set tripping. So I said, so for me to push a kid in here, I say, I have to throw them some dope and say, hey, smoke this, and then they're going to test
That's
you.
Crazy.
When you're dirty, you could come in.
And the whole point is you're trying to prevent them from getting to that point.
Yeah, thank you.
Right? So it's like they're not seeing the big picture.
Yeah, and then
NGOs,
if it's an eight NGO, you got a school, but it's not, you know, come on, man, you only work with kids with AIDS. But I should work with every kid, man. You know, to me, you know, if you're training these kids to be strong and all to be, you know, for the future wise, to be strong.
Yep.
That they was born infected with AIDS or whatever.
Yeah.
But you're teaching them how to be leaders.
Yeah,
how to tell people that their stories.
Yes.
You should teach them how to grow up with other kids too.
Yeah.
Normally.
Yep.
That's the difference.
Not just being their own
you know,
community or bubble, but
they just
interact
with all
with,
the kids that are infected. Yeah. To me, that's like caging them up.
That's tough.
You know, but then
it's another form of prison, right?
Yeah, you know, but then everybody laws was hard. Everybody, until Roseanne came at me and say, "You're special. You know, you're different. You're unique with the community and the people and the kids. Won't you be the first to do that?" And I was like, "I can't read. I can't write. I only could read." Eighth grade level, you know, if it's too high, I can't even read
it. It's intimidating, right? It's
It's like, if you ever watched the movies, movies about gang kids that don't know how to read and write, I am one of them.
Yeah.
Where people don't even believe me. Like people that grew up with me, like, for real, gang, you can't read? For real, I can't read.
Yeah.
And I ain't no shame. I fucked up, you know? You know? Guess what? I fucked up in life, you know? But then, now I'm trying to give it to the next kid and don't fuck up like me, you know?
Well, you're not just trying, you are. And you've been doing it for a long time.
Yeah, you know, at that time, I said, I want to try
and
make sure there's no kid that becomes like me.
Yeah.
You know, where I don't know shit, you know? I was just stupid, you know?
I always respect you for that, man, not to cut you off. But, you know, we don't know each other that well, where we hang out every day and shit. But when I was here, I knew the story of the deportees, and I recognized you guys, and to see you doing something positive when everyone else is just scrambling for theirs, which I understand, that's what people do, but I've always respected that you do that, man. You know?
Thanks, brother.
Yeah.
Still here, man.
Still kicking.
Yeah. You know, and then, you know, you meet a lot of people and say, the reason why KK stick with Tiny Toon Car, you're getting paid good. Man, y'all make thousands of dollars and y'all still complain. I'll still make the chump change.
Yeah.
And till now, I still make chump change.
Yeah.
And then I ain't got proof nothing. The only reason, because I don't know what y'all do with y'all money.
Yeah.
But me, and it goes to my family, my kid.
Yeah.
And when I go out, I don't blow the money.
Yeah.
I get free stuff, promoting clubs.
Yeah.
Doing your show.
Well, you're a networker.
Yeah.
Right? You connect different communities.
I don't go out there and buy 2-3 bottles.
No,
I can't afford that. That's like half my paycheck.
Yeah.
You know, or more.
Yeah,
if you're talking about 3 bottles, that's like $600. Back then, I barely make $850 now.
Yeah.
So how can you afford that? But if I'm doing a show, I want 2 free bottles yeah. and a bunch of coke. Yeah. That's for me and my people.
Do you now, like, when you see people, like, whether it's your own people here, whether it's friends, whether it's, you know, tourists or whatever, go out and waste so much money partying, do you in your head start calculating, man, that could feed, you know, 50 of these kids for a week, or that could keep the light bill and the rent, or, you know, like, I do that.
I do. I used to, but then I look at if my friend's here for a vacation.
Yeah.
They, you know, I know they're rich, you know, yeah, but yeah. if they want to here to enjoy themselves, you know, if they want to help 100, 200, I'm happy to give
that's
it
something,
to them.
That's something.
It's something.
Yeah.
You know, but then some people are just saving up and to enjoy, you know, and then, you know, you look at, I know they're blowing out there, but then at the same time, I look at, man, this man probably worked 2 years to get out here, so
yeah,
that
yeah.
I wouldn't even, like, try to make him.
You can't put it on the
yeah,
shoulder.
Yeah, so then know. Once he's done here, he got to go work hard again.
Yeah.
So I look at it like, yeah, you know, I don't even think like that no more because, like, me, myself, I always tell myself, one day I'm going to have a good vacation, you know?
Yeah.
But with my family, like, either to, like, Singapore.
You're going to be up in Disney World in Singapore, right? Hong Kong.
Thailand. You know?
Thailand.
Even my whole family never been to Siem Reap yet, you know?
Yeah.
But then, at the same time, I want to, like, have a nice, good vacation. Then, you know, if I could have, like, say, $4,000 just to be out in Singapore or Thailand or Vietnam or whatever, to enjoy your 2 week, I don't mind blowing that $4,000
for
my family. Just they came back happy and, like,
the kids
that
will
was
remember
fun.
That forever, right?
That's what I, you know, it's like my dad used to take us Magic Mountain. Man, it's
where
broke
did you grow up?
Hell.
Southern
Long
California,
Beach.
Right?
Long
Beach.
Beach,
yeah.
And he broke as hell, but, you know, it took him, like, man, like, when I was, like, when I went to, it was, like, one, I only went there one time, like, maybe 11, 12.
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't, you know, we can't afford all the food that, like, other people could.
Yeah.
Pay to get in, little food, we couldn't. Eat big food.
My
mom was packing her
in her
rice.
I was about to say that, right? Yeah.
Yeah,
like
you know,
I used to do that too, you know?
My mom had all her stuff in her
thing. Snacks in the purse.
Yeah, you know, and then I still remember that. My dad's like, yeah, we'll be back here next year. And all of us like, for real? He's like, I think about it, but I know we're never going to come back for another 10
years. But it
was
like one of the best memories of your
childhood, you know?
Right?
Yeah, and it's...
You're trying to do that for these kids.
Yeah,
too.
For him.
So you mentioned... like some of the kids that you were helping and the problems, like kids born with AIDS.
Yeah.
Is that a lot of those? Is it pretty?
Now it's kind of.
It's getting better.
Better. It's kind of dying out with this. I had like 3, but now they're all old now. They probably got jobs and everything.
Thank God, right?
Yeah,
they're
all good. But the new ones, I haven't met no new one yet.
So you think there's more in Cambodia? There's.
More protected of
a lot more education about sex and what, you know, condoms.
Now everybody know about that, you know. So, and everybody's getting trained up for it. So, I think.
So that's good. There's some, that's what's so interesting about this country. I was thinking about it, and like, so I was here 2014 to 16, right? Now it's modern. Like, I'm amazed that Phnom Penh is so much more modern and big money and people from all over the world and, right?
Everything.
It's like a melting pot, right? But 2014 to 16 was more like 2004, which is more like the 90s, which is more like the 70s in this country. So there were still, I mean, I remember, and you have a million stories, I'm sure, but I remember going by bars and, you know, the AK-47 is sitting out there and, you know, you go on the riverside jogging in the morning and you're like, is that a dead body? What the hell? You know, like, but it's changed a lot.
Yeah, it changed a lot, though. It did, you know. Everything went from, like, food went high. You go to certain places and the food could be skyrocketing.
Yeah.
And then you could still find the cheap food and stuff. But then, you know, like, it's not that much of polices like before. Now they got a little booth where they, but they're slow, you know, because they don't get paid.
Do nothing.
If a crime just hit, it's going to take them at least a 30 minutes to an hour to get there. They ain't in no rush.
So it's like Long Beach.
Take a shower,
So it's like Long Beach.
Go take a shower. Hurry up, man. We just
comb your hair, put on your good belt, right?
Yeah. So.
Man, that's crazy. And so, I know you started Tiny Toons in 2004, but when did you arrive here?
2004.
It was 2004, so quickly, huh?
Yeah. Because once I got here, my mom just told me, just do something with your life. You know, like any job don't have to pay you or $20, $30. Just do it, you know, yeah. So you don't keep busy.
Yeah.
But she was scared of the city for me. She was thinking about the rice field.
So she wanted you
in the rice field.
She wanted you. She thought there was too many bad influences.
It was my tattoo that scared. You know, I didn't have the face and all that, then it was the hands or the shoulder. So she was trying to hide me.
So is she from Battambang?
Yeah, my mom and dad's from Battambang.
Okay, okay.
So they put me out there for like a month.
You were bored as hell.
Hell yeah. It's like a ghost town.
Climbing a tree and it's hot as hell. Yeah. And I don't know about Battambang. Is that?
Yeah.
Do you go out much these days?
No. Once in a full moon, once in a while when the boys call, one of my friends come down from state.
Yeah, yeah. Then you got it.
Then sometimes if like, say Wicked call me out, like, hey, you want to catch up?
Special occasions.
Yeah, right. Let's do it. And then, you know, stuff like that. But if it's just not like before no more.
No, I'm
now what people say.
Super chill.
Let's have a meeting for Tang Tung. Back then, that's how I fucked myself up. Promoting Tang Tung so much that I drank. You know, I came to Cambodia and don't know how to drink.
Really?
I became a professional drinker of being working for Tang Tung. Because everywhere I go, I have to drink.
Yeah.
And then that's how I
What was it you were working for? What brand or what kind?
No, I wasn't working for a brand. I was promoting Tiny Toon. But every big people I meet, they kept on downing me with liquor,
well,
alcohol.
Everything social.
You know, I had to go down.
Happy hour, you got to go out to drink.
And then you meet some Oknya guy or some rich guy, they always trying to kill you.
They got the bottle, right?
Yeah,
they ain't fucking with beer cans, right?
And they don't give you no little shot. They trying to fill up your cup, like. Make you down it.
And it's a test, right?
Yeah,
it's like a test of endurance, right?
You don't take it, you like look down on them, take it, you the brother.
You go home early, then you ain't getting the donation at the end, right?
So I've been trying to, that's how I end up throwing up blood.
Yeah.
Yeah, too much alcohol. Now I'm banned from alcohol.
So I feel bad for asking if we could drink beers, but
No.
This ain't alcohol.
I'm not talking about like beer. Beer's doctor.
This is
cool.
As they call it in Thailand. This is special.
I'm talking about bottle like Henny, Chivas, vodka.
That ain't good for you. Yeah.
Yeah. No more of that. I mean, that was a bad experience.
Yeah, man, that's rough. Yeah.
And then you know when we at the cool lounge, every time I call people, I could be sick, and people say, "Hey, how about a bottle?" And I'm like, oh, I can't drink. They're like, oh, I don't
so think I think that's right when I was leaving. I think it was like the last 6 months you guys had that. Was that around 2016 or something, 15, or the lounge?
I forgot. We had it for 3 years.
I thought it was because I came to some, I thought it was the opening.
Nah, the landlord, that's one thing I hate about Cambodia. They try to really work us.
Yeah.
So we was okay. We was... Either we lose $30 to $40, or we make, $30 to $40.
Yeah.
Sometimes we could lose $100, sometimes we could make $100 something. We was like this, but then we could still keep on going.
Yeah, the lights were on, right?
But then when our 3-year contract was over, the landlord said recontract, and then it was $1,005 for us already, and they want to raise $800 on us, and like. And then we asked for $200. Can we raise $200 instead of? Because now we know in the cool lounges, people start knowing more about it.
More consistent, right?
Yeah, but guess what? No. And then how we really lost was all the equipment we bought, we built, and then we had to repaint it. And then, you know, this is how scandalous they are.
So it was all like graffitied up inside.
Yeah, but then we did paint it all nice and clean.
Yeah.
And they said that wasn't their color paint. And their house was shitty. It was old house. The walls all fucking stained up.
We just painted
over, and then we painted brand new, and they say it's not their color. And they took $1,400 from us for their paint. And I was like, damn.
That's just legal robbery, man.
Yeah, because they're rich. Their family's rich.
What are you going to do? Nothing.
What are you going to do? You can't do shit.
Big fish eat small fish, man. That's, you know. But, no, that's all good. So, when you came over in 2004, when you came over, so your mom was already living in Battambang?
She
was
my mom and dad's in the U.S., both of them.
Okay. So, yeah, give me the backstory. Grew up in Long Beach, right?
Yeah, so I grew up in Long Beach. I started breakdancing at age 8. Breakdance all the way till 12, 13. You could say around 13. And you could say 11, 12, I started graffiti, doing tag-ins, and end up joining a tag-in crew.
Okay. What were they called?
CRK.
CRK, what'd that stand for?
Crazy Royal Kings.
Okay.
Okay, oh shit, this story is interesting.
we're getting into the good stuff.
It's a trip.
Now we're getting into the good stuff.
So, our dance teacher, my teacher, he wasn't better than us, but he showed us how to become who we are.
Okay.
And in Long Beach, I could say in the whole LA, our crew was so untouchable where our head was so big. Mm. So he made this crew that we was kind of hot, like different kid. We had a white kid, we had a Filipino kid.
So it wasn't just Cambodian?
No, it was a mixed group, but more Cambodian kids.
Yes, yeah.
So we was Air Force. We kinda, cause Danny knew Air Force, and he created Ground Force.
Okay.
And then he'll get Air Force to come train us, and then.
And what's Air Force? I'm sorry.
Air Force is like Rocksteady Crew.
Okay.
Air Force is like the LA top notch.
Okay.
Dancers.
They were in, huh?
They was like the top, and Air Force and Rocksteady was like the main.
So when they showed up,
East Coast,
that was
West Coast,
deal.
Shit. Yeah, that, yeah them yeah. two was like the shit.
Man.
So.
And what year was this again? Like around.
It was like early 90s.
When everything was coming up, right?
Yeah.
When everything
you could say 89. 90, 91, whatever. I mean, we was like some, I ain't gonna lie, our crew was like one of the top notch.
Yeah.
Where like, now I see people spending 90s, doing 90s.
Yeah.
Like so many rounds, 30 rounds and
stuff.
In our days, 9 rounds, 9 times.
Spinning on your head or something?
On your hand.
Yeah, on your hands.
Was top notch.
Yeah.
And our crew was so vicious on like certain things. Like I was talking about, we were like circus kids. Like I do head spin on your head, like drill
crazy,
it
like
back, and then we all could do crazy ass flip. We were like, we never took gymnastic, but we was like, you know, we used to call this one flip called "Homie Don't Play That," like Living Color shit. Yeah. So yeah.
Do you have? Of that crew, is there any video that still exists? Any photos?
I doubt it. I don't know, unless you could find Danny, that's our teacher.
Yeah, you don't know where he is.
Yeah, I don't even know where he is no more. We used to love to go around to like parties and act like we don't know how to dance and people showing off, and then we doing like, I do like some, like trying to flair, but really I'm more pro at all this shit.
Yeah.
But then I act like, oh shit, and then when the battle hit, you'll just make everybody like, fuck.
They're like, what?
Stupid
the hell?
Sick.
Yeah.
You know, that type of shit. Yeah. Our whole crew was stupid sick.
That's amazing.
Because our teacher was taking one kid from here, taking
all from Long Beach or that.
Nah,
area.
Different.
LA
yeah.
Also.
Yeah, we had crews.
Best
from
of the best, huh?
Best of the best.
Let me ask you, in the LA in that time, what kind of music was kicking? Because I know on the East Coast, you know, 80s, 90s, but was, I mean, this is before Chronic and before, you know, it was NWA and...
No. Yeah, NWA, but
that's not really
for breakdancing.
Yeah.
For breakdancing, we was street jams. Street jams, Stevie B. You know, we was more about, you know, like, mostly street jam type of stuff.
Because the whole West Coast sound hadn't really taken off yet. I mean,
and in my generation, it was all about speed and not touching nothing. You know, your feet hit the ground, you're cheating, you're touching it. You know, like make it go high. You
That's
know,
incredible.
Yeah, and everything was about speed, how fast you could do your head spin, how fast your windmill, your flare, and your connection, your combos. Yeah, it was just.
So how many kids were in this crew? I mean,
we was like about 13. we have from poppers to, you know, like maybe like five poppers.
Yeah.
And then the rest all power, like stupid power.
Damn.
Yeah. I was crazy in Hespin, but then we had a white kid named Coco.
Coco.
More stupid than me.
Kid named Coco.
Yeah, a white kid named Coco, man. I was like, fuck.
He could do it, huh?
Ooh, that kid, man, he was killed. Like, when I started doing Hespin, I was like, shit, I'm the shit, you know?
Yeah.
But then when he learned his shit, I was like, that nigga's stupid.
He has some talent, huh?
Oh, he had talent.
Did you guys have like little matching outfits and shit?
Yeah, when we always try, from hairstyle to everything.
Starter jackets and shit.
The little bangs in front, bangs back, you know, blood.
Man, there must be some photos or video. We gotta hunt those down.
Cute little photos. And then where we fucked up is when we start joining the tagging crew.
Okay.
And then one day we all asked our moms to go to Danny's house. He was trying to be a DJ at that. He was like around, I think his age was like 18, 19 already.
A little older than
Yeah, so he was still living with his mom and stuff, but he had a little garage. We all five, six of us stay over and practice and whatever while he's DJing. And then I guess one day we decided like, let's fuck up the whole neighborhood.
Mm.
And we did. We fucked the whole neighborhood. I'm talking about everywhere.
And where was he? Like, in what neighborhood was he in?
Oh, I forgot what street where he lived.
But I mean, Long Beach.
Yeah, Long Beach. Then.
So it was like, yeah.
He was in Long Beach. So we destroyed the whole place. When he came out, he knew it was us. Mm. And then he gave us a choice. He said, what you guys really want? You guys want breakdancing? Or you wanna be taggers? We couldn't answer that. Cause we loved it both at that time. And then I guess he got mad at us. He never picked us up no more. Cause he's the only one with the car that could pick all of us up.
Oh man.
So that's how Ground Force died.
Yeah.
And then when we all our dance crew, we ask each other. We still call each other.
Yeah.
Like, what the
hell? I'm the landline, you
Let's
know.
Let's join your gang. Let's join your gang, right? So I guess, worst of the worst, a lot of our crew joined their gangs, different gangs. If he's Filipino, he joined the Filipino gang. Cambodian joined Cambodian, whatever. And then it was like about six of us that was left. And then we were like, what are we going to do? Like, fuck it, just stick with our tagging crew.
Yeah.
So we did. Start fucking up. We look up to the older gangs, like role models.
Okay.
Went against the SAs because of our Cambodian gangs.
Okay.
And then we got big.
And you guys, like,
yeah, straight taggers. Yeah, we start. Yeah, we just fucked around and tagged. We were just destroying shit for shit. I got kicked out of Poly High School for crossing out the Bugs Bunny. The only motherfucker to cross out the Bugs Bunny. But there was no evidence.
Yeah.
They accept me back though.
Yeah.
No, you know, the Bugs Bunny, I cross it all up, tag it all up.
They knew you did it, but they couldn't prove it. Huh?
Yeah, but there was somebody that told them I did. That's why they kicked me out. But they still couldn't prove it, so they had to let me back in. Then I did it again, and then I kicked it back.
Then you made it official.
Yeah, the whole school.
So were you just like, you know, you guys weren't doing like murals and art and stuff yet, or did you guys have like names? And
yeah, names, and, but then, you know, everybody, see, my name been KK as a dancer.
Yeah.
So KK was given to me by Asian boys.
Okay.
The old heads.
Yeah.
For Crazy Kid.
Oh, okay.
Spelled with K.
Yeah.
They didn't spell it because of it. You spell with a C as K. It's like,
well, this
killer,
is in the
know?
Days of crisscross, of course. So,
so they spelled mines with a K.
Yeah.
So, I had KK the whole time for Crazy Kid. Because the reason why they call me that, because anything, you know how all these stunts that people do nowadays, jump on roof, do flips?
Yeah.
We was one of them kids that was playing cops and robbers and doing flips.
Ooh.
And an old guy could come and say, I bet you won't try to do no backflip off that high roof. But you are with that.
Yeah, so, you are KK. Yeah. You are crazy.
But then,
kid.
As I got older and we started tagging, I never used KK on the wall.
Yeah.
I use crew, I use lacquer, crewer, you know, nicknames.
Yeah.
So they'll never catch who the hell is crew. And then we used to have these stickers, bunch of stickers. Go in every locker, bang, bang. The whole row would just be all us. Bang, 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 everywhere. And our hood got, our tagging crew got so big that we had, man, from deaf people, from the tagging crew, we had racers that was called RR and shit, and we changed Royal to Ruthless.
Okay.
So it was crazy, Ruthless Kings.
Yeah.
And then from there, we had so many cliques. And then at the end, all the gang members, when we, I went to jail already after this time. They had a peace treat.
Okay.
And then they went against us.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
And how old were you at this time? Like high school age or?
Yeah, still high school age.
Okay, yeah.
But I got locked up.
Yeah. So all the gang members came at you guys?
Yeah.
Because you guys were just getting too big, right?
Yeah.
Your name was out there too much.
Yeah. So we end up, they gave us a choice. You could join any gangs, but we can't claim CRK no more.
Okay.
And then, but we, as these tagging crew, already have friends that lost their life on it. So we said, you know what? Since we can't be CRK, we're going to just be CO.
Okay.
And become our own gang.
Okay.
And then, yeah, we beefed it with the whole Long Beach after that.
Yeah, wow.
We was getting fucked up.
There's only six of you, right?
Nah, we were deep.
Really, really?
But once the war hit,
yeah,
we disappeared like flies.
And then it was mostly Cambodian?
Yeah. No, it was every race in our
Which is pretty rare, man.
Yeah, but
a lot of times everything instantly becomes
a If you could race, say if you're going against the whole Cambodian gang in Long Beach,
yeah,
you're not gonna
yeah.
But you could say this. When that happened, we were so big, but when the war kicked off, there was only like 20 or 30 people that fought it all the way through.
Yeah.
That like kept this soldier.
So when you say the war, it was like, was there one big year or one incident when all the
we was the longest Cambodian gang with a green light by every Asian gang till I think 2004. When I even came here, we still was with the green light by them.
Damn.
Yeah, so I was like, wow, we're the first.
So in your neighborhood, like, not a great neighborhood, just assuming, or was it okay?
Yeah.
Middle class or no?
Yeah, you could say it's poor area. Like,
yeah.
But then we was everywhere, so. You know, until now, the war stopped. Everything stopped, and then we're still alive.
Yeah.
And then, you know, that's why now when I meet a lot of older gang members who created KK,
that's amazing.
Yeah, and I went to jail. One little tattoo that say Ruthless Gang, and
so were your parents that in Long Beach?
Yeah.
Were they from Cambodia, and then they got
they was
the
refugees.
Camps in Thailand, and then came over? Okay, like a lot of same as a lot of you know the deportees here and stuff, with traces back and stuff. So then with the war, like you had gone from dancing and having fun and it's all
tagging,
good to tagging to gangbanging. Now you're gangbanging. Right?
Yeah, everything. That's why sometimes you know from everything that I love doing. I took it all the way from breakdancing to tagging to gangbanging.
Yep.
Once I went gangbanging, I told myself, I'm going to tap myself up, make myself look more crazy, and then I'm going to be a soldier all the way through.
Yep.
And I did.
Yep.
I went there and I went out like a soldier and, you know, never bow down
to
whoever wanted to be for whatever. I just took it all the way through. For a little skinny kid that went
all heart.
Yeah, I just went, you know, it was the love, you know, everybody, you know, that, you know, still stuck with us. Then when the war stopped, now you have all these guys that ran off, come back and say, yeah, they're still part of you. But to me, I don't care, you know what? I let it go. Ain't nobody really, you know, came visit me, see me.
Was there any affiliation with Crips, Bloods, or anything, or was that not even?
Our color started because of We're catfish gray because that means blue and gray.
Okay.
Because Crip family, we all have brothers and sisters from Crips.
Okay.
And gray, we all have families from there. So we started catfish gray.
So I chose the right one, huh?
No, that's blue.
I know, but it's not red. At least it's not red, yeah, right?
So
I didn't have a gray one.
And then some of my hood represent blue, some represent gray, and
but
some
it wasn't
represent
like
catfish gray.
Yeah, it wasn't like
yeah,
a real,
yeah, but because we looked up to everybody. Yeah, and then, yeah. But then at the end, we still got the green light, and we still got ass smashed everywhere.
And what does green light mean? Everyone could just start firing on you whenever
just
they see you?
Wherever they see us, they could attack us from jail to the street.
Jesus. So when you were, so now you're in high school still, how old were you like when the war hit and all that?
I was 17.
Okay.
17.
And like
turning 18.
And what did that look like? I mean, it wasn't just fist fights, right? I mean,
We get stabbed up, get shot, get whatever. But me, I was locked up. I had it more harder than most of the homies.
So what? When did you get locked up? Like how old were you?
I was 17, turning 18.
Okay.
So in a couple of months, I turned into a dog. I go to LA County.
Yeah.
And then LA County was greenlit by Mexicans already, so they had. They take us to the gang module, like me and so they didn't take me to Asian. Then the cop was like thinking like, it's just a baby, can't take him to the gang module. Like, I'm a gang member.
Yeah, that's what you
skinny,
said.
Skinny, small, yeah.
That's what you said?
Yeah, and I went up there, there were so many gangs up there of Asian gang, and I'm the only one out there. Yeah, but I went in there, represent.
God damn.
Yeah, whoever cussed me out, I cussed them out. Yeah, they had to lock me.
You can't back down. One,
yeah, I didn't
one
back
bit,
down
right? Yeah.
All the way through. You know, whoever got a problem with me, you know, just open the cell, take it through. Yeah, I made it through all the way.
How many years did you stay there?
Prison, I was in the county for like a good year and in the gang march about a year and some change.
Okay.
Then I went to prison. Then I stayed there for prison about almost a year.
Where were you at for that?
I think it
not
was,
Pelican Bay.
No. It was
somewhere
just,
in California though.
I'm not sure. Yeah. It's a long time. So I forgot.
Was county easier than prison?
Mm-mm.
No?
Harder.
Really?
Wait. Shit. When
county's crazy.
Yeah.
Huh?
County I was locked down. We were locked down like 24 hours per day.
Yeah.
We get 1 hour a yard a week. So, and gang marshal, we don't get yard.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter. Yeah. So you full shitty. But when I went to prison, everything was good. And then.
And what were you, if you don't mind me asking, with respect, what were you in for? What did you get arrested for?
I went in for second degree robbery. Charged me with first, but I got dropped down to a second degree robbery.
Yeah.
So yeah, when my first crime was a second degree robbery. And yeah, and then after I did my prison, finished it, thought I was going home, immigration picked me up. Ended up doing 3 years for their ass. Longer than my,
all right, so you're getting out, mm-hmm. and like did you actually see the light of day? Like you were in the parking lot or before you were getting released, they came and got you out of the prison?
So they take you to this little holy tank when you get released. So they give you your thing, bam, 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 you change your clothes like that.
You're all excited, home. Right?
And then, boom, when the bus come, they say, call everybody by name.
Yeah.
Go out. And then they'll tell you, like, oh, you got an immigration hole. You know? Like, immigration hole? I ain't fucking an alien.
Yeah, so, I didn't sneak it over a border.
Yeah, so that's how, then. Yeah, stayed there for like a good 4 hours.
Hello.
In the holy tank, immigration picked me up. Yes, yeah, it's been 3 years for them.
Jesus.
For free.
Jesus.
Yep, then they
finally. And that was just because, like, when your parents, I'm guessing, but when your parents came, they didn't
become
do
citizen.
All the paperwork, right, which no one
they,
would.
They don't even speak English properly
till
nowadays. This wasn't, nobody ever taught them. Now they're American citizen after they lost me.
Yeah.
You get what I mean? But it's too late, you know?
Oh, and coming from what they went through here, no one's going to filling out, you know, going to their office and filling out paperwork for their kids in the U.S.
My mom don't even leave the house.
Yeah.
Only my dad. He goes drive around.
Man, so 3 years, and were those 3 years pretty chill, or was it harder?
It was hell.
Was it really?
Yeah, it was hell. We
same shit all day.
Yeah, we do a lot of crazy shit, you know, kick up riots, beat up people for fun now. I was a stupid motherfucking immigration. I had my little routine that where the CO don't, like, they're used to me. Like every fucking morning, I'll wake up, I'll cuss everybody out and slam the fucking door like 4 or 5 times and go back to sleep. Or sometimes, like, lunchtime or dinner time, I come with a bunch of toilet paper because, you know, we get movie, like, once a week or something.
Okay.
I saw the movie God Must Be Crazy.
Okay.
Yeah, so I wrapped myself with toilet paper and had a little plastic thing walking around, you know, like the African movie, the God Must Be Crazy.
I love that movie. Yeah. I don't remember the toilet paper.
No, I wrapped it up just to what he was wearing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like I don't have no clothes on. All toilet paper. I did thing, walk around. Yeah. Like, blah, blah.
You're just like, hey, I'm going to let you know I'm here.
You know what?
Oh my God, that's
we can't get no time.
Yeah.
We're not called inmates. We're called detainees.
Yeah.
And they can hold us indefinitely.
Yeah.
Indefinitely mean life.
Yeah.
So when the fuck you
all of a sudden the Constitution, the laws, the rules, and you were born on U.S. soil, right?
No, I was.
You
I
came
was,
over. Okay. Yeah.
As a baby.
Yeah. But a baby, I mean, you didn't know any better.
But yeah, fuck them.
But man, that must have been crazy in immigration too, because everyone speaks different languages.
Yeah, and, so riots kick off with racists and you know, and then we like Cambodian, Laos, Vietnams, Cubans, we can go nowhere.
They don't play either, huh?
Yeah, we're riding like a motherfucker.
God damn.
Yeah, but then there wasn't really such thing as getting a new case.
Yeah.
Because we don't exist in their book.
Yeah. off the, they don't have to follow any rules.
Yeah, we can do crazy shit.
Timelines, attorneys,
burn the cell up, burn the whole shit.
People in the U.S. don't realize that shit, man, that there's a big gray area, and we think, we like to say how great our country is and how free everyone is, but that applies to, 40%, 60% of the country.
Oh, they quit.
Yeah.
They make you, in immigration, they make you disappear once they think you're fucked up. They make you
disappear. Could your family visit you, or they probably couldn't even risk? They couldn't risk showing up and signing up or something, right?
It can't. They can, but it's too far, you know. And at immigration, not yet. You go first. They like to what they call it, move you around.
Yeah. Wow.
So, and then when they move you around, you don't get no phone calls for a couple of days. You know, I was so tired of immigration where I was going. If they would have kept me longer, I would have think I would have went psycho.
Yeah.
You know, like, fuck.
Yeah. I was about to say that fucks with you. If that's your whole world and then you get moved, you can't. You feel like you're cut off from reality.
Yeah,
right?
So how the fuck? So you can say this. When they move you, they move you like, they'll take you out of your cell like early in the morning. You wait until like nighttime or something for the bus or something, but you're in a cage.
Yeah.
And then when you're from that cage, they take you on a bus. From that bus, they'll take you to another cage. From that cage, and that was like 3 in the morning.
You don't even know where you are.
And then from 3 in the morning, they can move you. There's no bed, there's no nothing. Move you again, and then go somewhere else. Then, and you're in like this super cold AC blast out shit. You're cold, you're tired, you're sick, you're hungry. And then they take you to another place. And then all suddenly, the bus come pick you like maybe 2 in the morning. Take you out to go on this plane for a couple hours of flying. But they don't tell you where you're going. You just go on this plane, private jet with
Con Air.
You know, go, boom, drop you off. Go in there, write your name. Like, you're getting processed into another jail.
Yeah.
Process takes probably like 7 to 8 hours of processing, get your ID, then probably make your fucking bed, and they move you right back out again. Like, what the fuck is this shit? Why didn't you have to process? Just put us in a cage, motherfucker.
Yeah.
Process us. You know why I think they process people? To get their numbers and points to get their money. You know, like, that's what like
privatizing the prison system.
Yeah, you know, it's like
the biggest bullshit.
Like sometimes NGOs just do. They want numbers. They just make up numbers. How many numbers? So they could get all these money to their pocket. Yeah. Sometimes the prison, I think, it's the same thing. They take you around and just throw like 100 people in here.
So they could show that they have certain numbers that they
And then
even if it's just processed.
Just, process you in for 8 hours, and then 2 hours later, move you right back out. Like, that's go rest for 2 hours, and then once you're asleep, pack up, roll up, pack. It's torture.
That's some Guantanamo Bay shit.
Yeah.
You don't know where you're going.
They just doing this. Yeah,
that happened a lot.
Oh yeah, I was going psycho with them. When I was leaving, I was coming to Cambodia, I was like, "Oh fuck, they just sent us, man! 6 months of going back and forth, different county jails."
So you said you were in originally for the in county and stuff for robbery, right?
Yeah.
What were you robbing? Allegedly. I got you.
No, no. So this most of the crime. Like I said, I never got caught for my crime. I get caught for dumb shit.
Yeah, that's how it works,
that's
right?
That's why I believe in karma.
Yeah, that's
so,
how it works.
Really, it's a person actually.
Okay.
Bunch of kids like us, lonely, ready to beat up some chungos at that time.
Some what?
Essays.
Okay, yeah.
We was just roaming the street, all in blue,
Bald
head with genies and all that shit. Yeah. We was gang banging to the fullest.
Yep. But I mean, that's the year, then the other year and change. That's more than paying your debt to society for that crime. Within 3 years, being not even existing in the system and being like,
that's
fucked up. I mean, that's
really shitty.
Yeah.
And it was, didn't even get caught, you know, so snatch a purse. A friend pointed a toy gun at her. Bang. Back off. It's a toy gun, though.
Yeah.
She back off. Ran off.
It's a weapons charge, right?
First degree robbery with a firearm and kidnapping.
Yeah.
How is kidnapping? Can you move her back?
Yeah.
So they charged her. So it was retarded. And then, but me, at that time, I was on drugs, too, and I was ready to do drugs. So we split up, we got to go wherever, then there was three of us that were still there.
What was your, what were you on, if you don't mind me asking?
We were smoking Primo, cracking weed.
God damn, you were feeling good.
No pain,
man.
Yeah,
no
we
pain.
Went in the car, laid that in the yard, posted up, and the police car came, and I was like, oh shit.
Oh, shit, yeah.
Yep, but then we all looked the same anyway. So they picked me and my other homie, they didn't do shit.
Yeah.
He went to jail or something. Like, snitch on the guy with the gun, whoever,
He did?
No, the gun guy, everybody gone already. It was only three of us.
Oh,
but
the
lady picked two of us out of the three left.
The lineup, everyone looks the same.
Come on, we're all blue, y'all.
Yeah.
And then I was like, man, the gunman is like your size.
Yeah.
He's a small kid. He's only like, 16? But he was like, are your size already? Come on, man. How you gonna pick?
How's that gonna be me?
Yeah.
But then you had a weapons charge, which is a big, that's where it's a serious,
they didn't catch us with no gun.
Of course, yeah.
But we were young and dumb.
And once you're in the system.
I think I could have beat that in trial because her story switched.
But you know, in the U.S., man, you got to
hire
an attorney. That's the only way you could get justice.
Yeah, we couldn't afford no damn attorney.
Of course, that's why.
I didn't understand the damn word the judge or the DA was talking.
That's why 99% of people don't get justice.
I keep on saying time out. What's that? What'd you say?
You were calling a timeout?
Yeah.
Look at you. Like Tom Brady up in the courtroom calling a timeout.
Yeah, that's my first case.
That's crazy, man, but. Shit, I can't even imagine the shit that you were doing to survive and the shit going on in prison, man. That's wild.
Yeah, I just told myself be a soldier and go all up. If it's time for a knife, it's time for a knife. If it's time for whatever, I ain't gonna fight no big guy like you, but man, I'm gonna stab you up.
Yeah, of course. Of course. I'd stab me up too.
You know, any big motherfucker, I ain't gonna let the big motherfucker hit me, but I'm gonna stab his ass up first. He gonna run from my little ass. I might be on his bench.
What did you get a hold of? What did you make? What was like?
Everything we could get. Chicken bones, whatever.
Damn.
You know, what I'm scared of is like a lot of chicken bones. You know, sometimes the chicken bones can. If you get lucky, you get a long chicken bone.
And they don't break.
They don't keep splinter, it till right? Yeah, like, yeah, they sharpen all up. Yeah. But yeah, that shit. Oh, then sometimes they use
so the, chicken night, you had to watch your back the next day,
toothbrushes and all that, razors and shit.
Yeah. God damn. That shit scares the hell out of me, I'm not going to lie.
Oh, yeah, it scared me too. But then at that time, when you always say you're part of something and you're taking it to the next level, you just got to do it, you know?
Got to be on way, your... Right?
Most time with tennis shoes.
In immigration, were you clicked up and like with other Cambodians or no?
It depends where. Certain prison, I might run with my people.
Okay.
Certain prison, I don't run with.
Yeah.
They run with the wrong side, I don't run with them.
Yeah.
They run with the right side, I run with them.
Okay.
So what I mean is, if they run with like the blacks in the north, Nathaniels, I run with them.
Okay.
But they run with South Side and Whites, I don't run.
Okay.
So,
it's different.
Different prison,
And it's complex, right? Because you're arriving middle of the night, you're trying to get information from people, you're trying to see.
Now you can see it once you walk in the yard. When you're fresh, you might
be like confused.
Yeah, confused, and you might try to figure stuff out, and then you might run with the crowd because you don't know nothing. But me, after coming back 3 times, I already know my game.
Instantly,
you know, I could walk into a prison and I could be like, nah.
Wow.
Bust a U-turn and they'd be like, hey, you in the wrong side. Like, fuck you, get the fuck out of my face. I'm straight up, but my own kind, whatever.
Yeah.
And then, you know, even when I was my own people, Cambodian people try to check me, like, you know, you're going to get green light by this. I already got green light by y'all anyway, so I don't really.
Yeah.
And I say, yeah, you go tell your homies. I run with the blacks, and y'all run with Southsiders.
Yeah.
And y'all getting green light by Southsiders.
Yeah.
You know, it's...
Fucking hell.
Yeah, but it depends on certain prisons. So, me, I just do my own thing, you know? But then, most of the time, your people, when you already make your choice, they let you go.
Yeah.
They ain't gonna come get you.
Yeah. And not many people even make
they
their
do,
own choice, right?
Come get me. I'm always, like, putting myself where level, if I already choose my line, I'm gonna be ready for them if they do come, you know? Because that's part of life. You came in here by yourself, you're going to walk out here by yourself.
Thanks so much for listening, everyone, to part one of my conversation with KK on this episode number 30 of the Who in the World podcast. And look for episode number 31, part two of our conversation, coming very soon. I appreciate you guys subscribing, following, liking, sharing. Means a lot to me. And of course, thanks to KK and all the Cambodian deportees.